is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You laid down your life. That I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
See you high and lifted up. shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love as we sing, holy, holy, holy. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. Of my heart, I want to see you. I want to see you. To see you high and lifted up, shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love as we sing, holy, holy, holy. To see you high and lifted up, shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love as we sing, holy, holy, holy. Holy, holy, holy. Holy, holy, holy. Holy, holy, holy. I want to see you. To see you. Sing it again. Holy, look up to heaven now. Holy, holy, holy. Holy, holy, holy. Holy, holy, holy. I want to see you. Is holy. We need to always remember that whenever we come before Him. Just to open our hearts up humbly. But we need to embrace Him. He's our Father. He's waiting for us today to embrace Him. Most holy God. We come before you. We want to honor you. We want to worship you. We ask you to receive our praise today, Lord. We want to see you, Lord. As we sing, holy, 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 I want to see you. Thank you.
I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. From my mother's womb, you have chosen. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear.
Lord, be with your people today. And we do live in fearful times, Lord God. But we don't need to be slaves to the fear of anything, because you are our Lord. And you hold us in the palm of your hand. You love us with an everlasting love. You've drawn us with your loving kindness. Let us tap into that love. Let us feel the arms of our Heavenly Father around us this morning. Thank you that you're a good God. Thank you that you're there. Thank you that there's nothing in this world that can take away our confidence. There's nothing that can take away the promises that we have in you. We thank you and bless your name, oh God. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. God bless you. Why don't you take a couple minutes and meet a few people around you today? Say hi from a distance.
Yeah, but it's a kind of Moser special.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Well, good morning this morning. Why don't we try to find our way back to our seats? Yeah, we'll go turn the lights off if that doesn't work, right, Mike? Okay. All righty. Well, it's good to see everybody today. Thanks for making the time to be here today. And I would welcome guests, but I don't think we have any today, except behind the masks. I can't tell who everybody is, but I think I'm pretty sure. I read that about somebody that, what was that? She went to the store and had her mask on and got home and had the wrong husband. I don't know. So you got to be very careful. Very careful. So anyway, to welcome all of you and just thank you for being here. Thanks to you. So many of you came out last night. Didn't we have an amazing time? And we have a few people that weren't going to make it back today because of last night, and that's certainly understandable. But anyway, we want to go ahead and go forward here. Let me just remind you again, we need to try to maintain our distance. I know it's hard. We love each other. And you know the other precautions that are in place. And we don't want to do anything here to spread what's going on out there. But even though we've had a few people recover, Vicky's a recovering person. She's good forever. All right, hopefully, yeah. We might have a few others as well, but anyway. Just a few announcements here. The men's Bible study will be meeting tonight. We'll be meeting outside if it doesn't rain on us, so bring your lawn chair. And even if it does rain, we like to sit inside the garage and watch the rain, so encourage you to do that. Prayer meeting at the Wright's house on 6402 Langwood on Thursday mornings at 10. And we do have the carnival coming up on the 15th, and we still need you to sign up to volunteer for food and for just volunteering in general. Virginia, anything in particular I need to know, be aware of right now? Okay, and I'll send out a flock note to remind you of that. So that would be good and terrific. You got to understand how the communication system works in this world today. So you hit all the right buttons, and then you get the big promotion. So we need to do that. And we will be having a back-to-school theme, and we're going to be giving masks for kids to go back to school. All the kids that come are going to get a free mask. I think we got little dinosaur masks. So that should be cool. They should like that. Yeah, Rick wants one. Yeah, he's going to get in front of the line. He got excited when I said that. Dinosaur mask. All right. Also, we ordered the T-shirts this week. Wow, I was amazed. We had over 50 people order them. And we're going to have this shirt, and on the back of it, it's got the Ridge logo. I believe we can, if they still want the one, they can still order one. Is that correct? Yeah, we can do a second order. But we got all the stuff in place with the graphic work and everything. We got all that taken care of, so we don't have to pay extra for that. We can just add on. So if you're interested in getting a shirt and you didn't order already, see Laura. And I think that should probably do it. Is there anything else I'm missing out there? Yes. Okay, yeah, I was a really bad pastor last week when I kind of threw this together and made it kind of complicated in the offering. If you have not paid yet, when you pay for yours, write your check out to the Ridge, but give it to Laura. Does that make sense? Write the check out to the Ridge, but give it to Laura, and then she will take care of it from there. All righty? Does that make sense? Have I confused everybody sufficiently? No. Yes and no. All right. Let's take an offering, shall we? We're going to give to the Lord, and and once again, we always, always, always need to make this an issue of worship to the Lord when we give. Not out of obligation that we need to do this so something bad doesn't happen to us, but because we love God. Of course, He asks us to give, and we just want to pray. And let me pray that God is just going to use this for His kingdom. Father, we give our gifts to You today and do pray that You will use them to the maximum for your kingdom, Father God. We pray that we just offer these to you, Lord God, because we love you. We offer it as an act of worship. Now bless this offering, I pray, that it will meet all the needs and expenses of this church, and it will go forward to make a difference for the kingdom of God in this world. In Jesus' name, amen. Sing with us. You are Lord God Most High. I will sing, I will cry out and worship. I will worship you, King of kings above all. At your feet will I fall down and worship. I will worship you. Let's sing that verse again. You are Lord God Most High. I will sing, I will cry out and worship. I will worship you, King of kings above all. At your feet will I fall down and worship. I will worship you, Son of God, Son of man. I will lift up my hands and will worship. I will worship you. Draw me near to your side. Here's my heart open wide. I will worship. I will worship. In the joys of my days, when I'm blessed, I will praise you and worship. I will worship you. And through troubles of life, in my pain, in my strife, still I'll worship, I will worship you. And someday I will rise, we will meet in the skies, and I'll worship, I will worship you. I will live evermore in your presence, my Lord, where I'll worship, I will worship you. Son of God, Son of man, I will lift up my hands and will worship, I will worship you. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. We bless your name, Lord. Hallelujah. Well, we have a special guest with us today. He's going to share for a few minutes. Lisa Kay has been on her travels across the land. She can tell you more about it. She's a missionary, that one of our missionaries in Indonesia, and COVID has kind of messed her life up, but God has another plan, and we're going to hear about that.
Yeah, it feels like I was here just last year, and yeah, I was. And I shouldn't actually be here for two more years, but God had other plans for me, And he brought me home from Indonesia suddenly because, like the rest of the world, Indonesia got COVID. And my organization felt that I should come home because I have asthma, and that made me a health risk. And Indonesia is still a third world country, and their medical system is not very good. And so they brought me home for the time being. Right now, I'm actually trying to get back home to Indonesia in October. We'll see how that works. The way it looks, it's going to be really difficult. I have a passport issue, so I need a new passport. Passport offices are not open to me right now. And I'll have to have a COVID-free test taken within 7 days before I leave. I have to enter Indonesia before that 7 days are over. So to have both of those things happen before I go to Indonesia will be probably a pretty good indication that God wants me back home. So if I end up going back in October, it's only because God wants me there. And if I don't end up in Indonesia at the end of October, that means I have more work here to do. And so just before I left Indonesia, I felt that God was changing my ministry a little bit. And so I just wanted to mention that. If you get my newsletter, you'll have seen a little bit about that, but my annual report, which I send to people I have actual snail mail addresses for, you got a little more of an explanation. And so right now, what God is pushing me towards is to work with the Christian church in Indonesia. Like many Western churches, there are a lot of people in the churches over there that go there on Sunday and they don't spend the rest of their life like a Jesus follower. And so they don't realize that they actually have the Great Commission as well as the people like me that go over there to help. And so part of my ministry when I go back will be to work with the Christian church and get them to see what they need to do in order to do that. And part of that may be to evangelize the Christian church, because so many of them, we know here in America that we have people in churches that when Christ comes and they're going to say, hey, look at all the good things I did for you, and Jesus is going to say, I didn't know you. And they're not going to be welcome. And so we have to go into the churches there and take care of that, so that they will be willing to evangelize. And so that will be my change of ministry when I get back to Indonesia. And so I want you to be aware of that. I have a couple of cards that are in the little table in the lobby, and my regular prayer card, which is what World Partners has. And then I have a new prayer card, which has a picture of some Indonesians, a lady and her two children. These are bridge people, and the bridge people are the name that I give to the people group that is unreached that I am trying to reach. And this card has prayer points for the new ministry that I have. So if you don't get my annual report, which is mailed out, you won't have one of these. So there's some of both of these cards. If you would like to get on my mailing list and pray for me, I can always use more prayer partners. Just send an email to the email address that is on the back of this card and tell me that you'd like to be part of my newsletter. If you'd like to get my annual report and my Christmas card every year, you can give me your actual snail mail address as well. And so I want to thank this church for the prayers that are sent up on my behalf. And then also I do get donations from some of you, and I do appreciate that. That is necessary to be able to keep my ministry going. But I have to admit, God is good, and He has provided for me in every way since I've been in the field almost 4 years now. So thank you very much. I do appreciate it.
All right. So glad she could be with us. It was a nice very nice blessing that she's able to come through the territory, and Eileen and I got a chance to meet with her, and this has been great. So even though you had to stay away for a while, we're really, really glad we could see you again. Before I go to the word today, we're going to share communion, and I would like to do it at this point in the service. And we will have, I'll ask a co-church to come. They're going to be serving to us today. And like we've done before, what we'll ask you to do is come up and take, they'll be serving you individual cracker and then a cup of the juice. And then you can return to your seats. You can come up and receive from them. So I'll just encourage you, we'll start, as we've done in the past, we'll start on this side of the church and just go around. Jesus told us to do this until he returned, to remember. And this is something we need to do over and over. It's the theme of the church, but it's good to have this object lesson, isn't it? To remember, to hold in our hands the bread that represents his body and the cup that represents his blood. This is a holy act. And we're doing this because Jesus told us to. It's been going on in the church ever since he left. And it'll keep going until he comes back again. So let's pray. Father, I pray for this bread that we hold in our hands that represents the broken body of Jesus. We thank you, Lord, for what you did in bringing Jesus to suffer and to die. And Lord, I don't understand the suffering, but I'm thankful for it. I'm thankful for what it's given us. So as we do this together, we remember the primary reason why we are meeting together today as a church. So we take this bread and we eat it together to remember what Jesus has done. And it's in his name we pray. Amen. Let's eat the bread. I'm going to ask if Lisa could come back and share, pray over the cup this morning.
Thank you, Father, for all that you have done for us. And thank you, Jesus, for the blood that you shed for us. This cup, this juice represents your blood that was shed for us, that gives us salvation and the opportunity and the ability to worship you forever. And so, Lord, we as a church celebrate you, and we celebrate the remembrance of what this means to each and every one of us. Thank you, thank you. And so as we take this cup and participate together, thank you, and I pray that you would bless us in Jesus' name.
As we continue in our study of Jesus' life, we should, from the Gospel of Matthew, which we're calling King and Kingdom, I'd like to ask you to turn this morning to the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 6. Matthew, chapter 6. Say amen when you get there, so I know those of you that have the hard copies today. We're going to start reading right at the beginning, verse 1. Jesus is speaking, and he says, "Be careful not to practice your righteousness in front of others to be seen by them. If you do, you have no reward from your Father in heaven. So when you give to the needy, do not announce it with trumpets as the hypocrites do in the synagogues and on the streets to be honored by others. Truly I tell you, they have received their reward in full. But when you give to the needy, do not let your left hand know what your right hand is doing, so that your giving may be in secret. Then your Father, who sees what is done in secret, will reward you." As we return again to the Sermon on the Mount, let's remember that Jesus, here early in his ministry, is describing what life in the kingdom of heaven looks like. His kingdom is not of this world, so it doesn't look like the other kingdoms of this world. It doesn't have geographic boundaries, and the king doesn't wear a crown, at least not yet. But it's a kingdom nonetheless, and it's extremely real, even if you can't draw a picture of it or find it on a map. Thus far, Jesus has been focusing on attitudes of the heart for those who live in that kingdom. We looked at being salt and light, being honest, of loving our enemies. Now Jesus is going to turn his attention to actions, to activities that are considered to be good or to be righteous. But again, he's going to bring clarification to how those actions look inside the kingdom of heaven, contrasted with those same actions outside of the kingdom. Righteousness will be the general theme here for the first 18 verses we find in chapter 6. In the first part of the Sermon on the Mount, we've already looked at, Jesus laid down theological principles, ideals about heart condition and attitude, but now he's going to turn that theology into action. He's moving from the internal to the external. So we come to verse 1. "Be careful not to practice your righteousness in front of others to be seen by them. If you do, you will have no reward from your Father in heaven." Now, giving, prayer, and fasting were common religious practices of his own day. And Jesus chose these because at that time, they were considered the marks of a truly religious person. But in this introductory verse, he's making the point that these three areas are just examples. For instance, he's going to talk about giving, but he's not going to have an expose on explaining tithing and how money is utilized in the kingdom of God. Instead, he's going to talk about the issue of righteousness and righteous actions and how those operate inside of his kingdom. Giving is only going to be used as an illustration, as well as prayer and fasting that we'll look at later. But right off the start, it sounds like Jesus is contradicting what he just said a few minutes earlier. Back in chapter 5, he had said, "Let your light shine before men so that they may see your good works." He'd been encouraging us to do things so others would see them. But now he seems to be saying the exact opposite, doesn't he? What do we make of that? It really comes down to the second part of each statement. In the earlier verse, he had said, "Let your light shine so that others may see your good works," and then it ends, "and glorify your Father in heaven." Giving does not necessarily need to be anonymous. We read in the book of Acts that the early church knew that Barnabas had given income from the sale of his land. And when other church members laid their money at the apostles' feet, it wasn't secret. It wasn't done in secret. Everybody saw it. It's right in front of the church. Here Jesus is saying, be careful not to practice your righteousness in front of others to be seen by them. The goal, he's saying, is not to draw attention and glory to ourselves. It would be a huge mistake to trade the goal of pleasing the Father for the trivial and idolatrous goal of pleasing people. Jesus is primarily concerned with the motives behind all righteous living or righteous acts, as we would call them. An eagerness for human applause is to prostitute our righteousness. So now Jesus turns toward the three examples of giving to the poor, of prayer and fasting. And today we're going to focus on the first of these, giving. So when you give to the needy, do not announce it with trumpets as the hypocrites do in the synagogues and on the streets to be honored by others. You know, back in the Old Testament, there's a lot said about the poor. A lot of instructions. And let me just hit a few of these for you. In Leviticus, a few verses, do not go over your vineyard a second time or pick up the grapes that have fallen. Leave them for the poor and the foreigner. Also in Leviticus, if any of your fellow Israelites become poor and are unable to support themselves among you, help them as you would help a foreigner or stranger so they can continue to live among you. In Deuteronomy, if your neighbor is poor, do not go to sleep with their pledge in your possession. If they've lent something to you so you get to borrow some money, you got to give it back to them. Do not take advantage of a hired worker who is poor and needy, whether that worker is a fellow Israelite or a foreigner residing in one of your towns. And another one, pay them their wages each day before sunset because they are poor and counting on it. Now, this isn't quite all the instruction that was given about the poor in the Old Testament, but it basically pretty much captures everything God said about them. And there's several things here that encourage and command the Jews to be sensitive to the poor and to be generous. But there's nothing in the Old Testament law that directly requires anyone to simply outright give money to the poor. It's not in there. So the idea in Jesus' day that people would give to the poor was seen as a very pious act. When people would give something to them, or would give something to the poor, they were going above and beyond the law. And that's what made these Pharisees appear even holier than we already knew they were. That's impressive. The problem is that when the Pharisees were going to give, they held a press conference, so to speak. They'd publicly make a show of it, so that everybody knew what they were doing. Jesus said they announced it with trumpets. They would unsling a trumpet that they're carrying for such occasions and blow away till they've collected a crowd. Now, this is most likely hyperbole on Jesus' part. We don't have any record that they actually went around with trumpets announcing what they were going to do. This illustration is a humorous one, and Jesus probably intended to bring a chuckle to them when he said it. They did make a big stink about their giving, though. It was very public. And regarding trumpets, I guess we could say that they would blow their own horn. But we see that today, of course, as well, don't we? Some people of means will only use those means to help others when they get their proper recognition. I was reading again something happened a few years ago. A couple offered to donate $3 million to the New York City Central Park Zoo, half of what the zoo needed for a big expansion project they were doing. You can go to the next one, Mike. And for their generosity, the zoo would have their names prominently displayed at a plaque on the entrance. You can go to the next one. There we go. Now we're all caught up. The problem is, there had been another couple 36 years earlier that had donated $500,000, which 36 years earlier would be pretty much the same amount. And they already had a plaque with their name on it. And so they were going to put the new couple's name on a different gate. But the new donors didn't like that. They said, "We want you to take down the plaque of the other donors." But the zoo said, "No, we're going to keep theirs up too." So the new donor said, "Say goodbye to $3 million," and they retracted their gift. That's how people in the world act. That's what they do. They want attention and a lot of it for any perceived good deed that they may produce. But in the kingdom of heaven, God rejects that attitude completely. The Pharisees had fully embraced the opportunity to leverage their giving into an image-enhancing event. They didn't want to give their money to anybody unless they could be seen and praised for their generosity. Their mode was not to help others or to show gratitude to God. They really didn't care about helping anybody. It was more like an investment into their reputations. It's widely thought that giving to the poor ensured that prayers would be more effective. And, their prayers, therefore they could use the occasion to gain reputation and possibly fuel their prayers all at the same time. But their prayers were undoubtedly directed at exalting themselves and putting down other people anyway. The Pharisees' great weakness was that they loved praise from others more than God's praise. And Jesus would later confront him with these words, "How can you believe since you accept glory from one another but do not seek glory that comes from the only God?" Jesus called them hypocrites. We all know what that means today. Jesus is actually the only person on record in the New Testament that used that word, and he used it 17 times. As a matter of fact, I read this week that it's clear from the literary records that it was Jesus alone who brought this term, being a hypocrite, as a devious metaphor into the moral vocabulary of the Western world. Nobody wants to be called a hypocrite. I also learned that in Palestine in Jesus' day, there were numerous fine theaters, and one of them was located in the city of Sepphoris within a few miles of Nazareth where Jesus grew up, and it was actually built while he was a young man. So Jesus would have been familiar with the theater. The Greek word for hypocrite itself is a compound noun. It's made up of two Greek words that literally translate an interpreter from underneath. In ancient Greek theater, the actors, instead of, today in Hollywood, you got to put on the face, you got to cry or laugh or do whatever, they would just put on the mask like we see there to show what the character was feeling at the time. And here we get that sense of hypocrite because they're showing us a false face while their real face is underneath with an entirely different emotion on it. So a hypocrite is not a person who falls short of his high ideals or who sins occasionally. A hypocrite deliberately uses religion to cover up his sins and to promote his own gains. Jesus is warning about the sin of using religion to cover up sin. The righteousness of the Pharisees was insincere and it was dishonest. They practiced their religion for the applause of men, not for the reward of God, even though they were expecting this as well. So Jesus was rebuking the hypocrisy of very small men who pretended to be very large men. In contrast, Jesus said he's always looking for quiet devotion. Humility and holiness always go together. Look at the second part of verse 2. Truly I tell you, they have received their reward in full. Jesus said that those who have so craved attention from others for their righteous acts have already been rewarded. They already received their attention and their moment of fame. But Jesus said that that is all of the reward they would receive, all that would be issued to them. They wanted the praise of men, they paid for it, and they've gotten it. The transaction is ended and they can claim nothing more. They have the reward in full. As a matter of fact, they tell us that Jesus, the use of the word that Jesus used here indicates full payment with a receipt. The deal is done. God now owes them nothing because they were not giving anything. They were buying. When we do good things to be seen by human beings, that's because we're looking for something that comes from human beings. When we want human approval and esteem and do what we want for the sake of it, God courteously stands aside because by our wish, it doesn't concern him. Those things done for the sake of publicity that it brings will find that the only reward to expect is the reward of human publicity. Heaven will be silent about the matter. Giving is between the individual and God. The very minute that a third party gets involved, there's no longer any credit to be received in heaven. And of course, the general principle Jesus is teaching us here is about any so-called righteous act. Whether you're giving away $1 million or simply helping a little old lady across the street. At least the Pharisees were warned. You know, it's going to be a very tragic day. On the day of judgment, when so many people expecting so much reward from God are going to find out that their basket is empty because everything was done for the wrong reasons. So much of what has been done in this world has been done for personal glory. But many think that if it has some kind of spiritual or humanitarian angle to it, they expect to receive praise from God for it as well. Jesus said, don't count on it. Verse 3. But when you give to the needy, do not let your left hand know what your right hand is doing, so that your giving may be in secret. This is another classic line from Jesus. Don't let your left hand know what your right hand is doing. Now, scholars aren't sure if this phrase actually started with him. It might have been in play before he was there. But Jesus is emphasizing again the need to maintain secrecy as much as possible in our righteous actions within the kingdom of heaven. The original word for seen means to be seen by casual observation, not by having attention drawn to it. We're not to advertise our benevolence as the hypocrites do. Don't reach in your pocket with one hand for your wallet, put your other hand in the air to let everybody know what you're going to do. And I think we can make a connection here in the body of Christ as well. Within the church, we normally don't need to proclaim even to the brothers and sisters how much we're giving. Sometimes it may even feel more spiritual, but we can easily fall into the trap of pride, even when sharing among the church. Perhaps even easily more falling even more easily because of that. There's a guy in another church I was in. I won't mention the church or even the state, but this guy had a whole litany of the things he and his wife had done for the church. They had paid this much money to do this. They had donated this house, which cost this much money. And he had a whole list he would go through to tell you, itemized with dollar amounts, for anybody that wanted to listen, and also for everybody who didn't want to listen. He loved to tell you his score. their donation that helped the church. I mean, we got a free house out of it. But if Jesus is to be believed, and I think he is, I'm afraid my friend has long ago forfeited all of his heavenly reward. Unlike Charles Spurgeon and his wife, I was reading about him. I don't know if you're all familiar with him. He is a great preacher in the 19th century in England, in London. And pastors are, he's kind of like the hero for pastors. He was just in the pulpit a long time. Great man of God. But he and his wife had chickens. And the chickens laid eggs, and they sold the eggs. And they had a real strict policy because they never gave them away. You always had to pay for them, even their relatives. It's like, well, just give me a dozen. Nope, it's cost. You're going to pay. Put the money right there. And for that, they were criticized as being greedy, being self-centered. But in spite of that criticism, you're going to pay for the eggs. And nobody knew until both of them had passed away that all that money was used to support two widows. And that's why they wouldn't give it away. That's the kind of giving. That's what giving looks like in the kingdom of God. Back to the end of verse 4. Then your Father, who sees what is done in secret, will reward you. Jesus is trying to get his people to own their identity and motivation from within. To just act and forget about the rewards. He calls us to act for the truth of the action itself and not for human approval or for flattering self-image. Of course, that's radical surgery on the human spirit to do that. Jesus wants us to be the kind of people who've been so transformed by our daily walk with God that good deeds just naturally flow out of our character so instinctively that the left hand would not know what the right is doing. It's kind of like driving a car. You just do it without even thinking about it. Think about driving this morning. I mean, that hasn't been on your mind. You just do it by automatic pilot, right? You get in, you drive here, you get out of the car, you don't even think about it. It's just automatic. You woke up this morning and you spoke English. You didn't even think about it. Well, Jamil, how many languages you got to choose from? He has to choose from four languages and figure out. But most of us, we wake up and we don't even think about what language. We just speak it. And Jesus is saying that's the way righteous action should come out of us, without even thinking about it, without thinking about the consequences, about the rewards. They just happen to us. You know, no work of righteousness is more largely instilled in us than giving. And I don't want to spend a lot of time on giving itself, because this could apply to other things as well. But it's so hard when we want to do something because there's so many things that battle for our priority or for what we're thinking in our heads. You know, what temptations do we face when we give? Whether it's giving in the offering or giving to a neighbor or giving our time to somebody or giving in any way that we do. What's a temptation? Well, one of them is to escape the criticism, to gain the reputation of that we're not stingy. Just like that's something that Spurgeon's could have gone after, but they didn't. Sometimes we give because we just don't want to be criticized for being stingy. Sometimes we give to tax-deductible things because there's a tax deduction. There's nothing wrong with that, but that shouldn't be the primary motivation for anybody's giving. And sometimes just to salve our conscience. It's very easy for our motives to become mixed. But perhaps to do this, we simply need to redirect. Think about why we're doing things in a whole nother context. Last week, I was going out to my car to get in my car, and there's a lady that's been in the neighborhood. And she was walking by. I've never talked to her. I didn't know who she was. And she said, "Are you John?" I said, "Yeah." She says, "Oh," she says, "well, I'm staying with my father. Now, he's your next door neighbor." He said, and I just wanted to say hi. She said, "I live in Atlanta. I'm going back today." But she said, "You went over to his house during when the COVID thing started, and you told him that you would do anything that he needed. You go to the store for him, right?" I said, "Yeah." She says, "Well, I just wanted to thank you for that." I was like, "Wow, I can't believe he'd remember my name, much less remember anything," because he's just kind of like, "Never mind. I'm fine. Everything's okay." Now, I don't care about rewards. When I'm telling you this, I'm not expecting a reward from God for any of this. When I look at a situation like that, you know what my reward is going to be? My reward is going to be when I'm in my neighbor's house and I can share the gospel with him. My reward isn't to say, look, I did a good thing for my neighbor. Doesn't matter if he doesn't know Jesus. I don't care about the reward. I don't care about that reward. The reward isn't what I did. The reward is going to be when I see him come to Jesus. That's the reward. We need to look at it that way. It's not that I've done something. It's this end result that means something in the kingdom of God. My reward will be when I'm in heaven and I meet people, some people I don't even know. And they're going to say, are you John? Yeah. It's like, yeah, you remember when you went to the hospital and you were seeing somebody in your church and I was there and you prayed for me? That was the beginning of my journey that brought me here today. That's the reward I want. Not the reward that I'm going to get, the reward of seeing what happened in the kingdom of God. And I just use those as examples. Please understand, this isn't to promote myself, because I don't want rewards for what I'm doing. I don't care about that. I just want to see God's kingdom increase. And that's how we want to look at things. It can be a very difficult thing when we're doing things. It's like, am I doing this for myself? Or am I doing this because I really want to see the kingdom of God go forward? Now, I think I made a huge mistake. Because I have a video. Is there any way we can play audio off of that computer? Yes or no? I forgot to set this up ahead of time. Last night took me off the rails. I'm so sorry. I thought I had everything. I'm sitting there going, I'm forgetting something. The other thing, you know what you can do, Ethan, is in the SharePoint. I have the link to the video in SharePoint. Can you play that off of there? I'm so sorry about that. This is an awkward moment, isn't it? It is a pretty picture. Let me know if that's going to work or not. We're all in prayer. How's it working? Are we getting anywhere?
We just got into
This is a song that many of you have probably heard, and the whole point I'm trying to do here, spent a lot of time talking about the Pharisees, and this isn't us, but it's the principle. But the other thing I want you to see is to realize, and this is really the point of it, this is why, even though I messed up and I could just pass over this, this is such a big part of what I wanted to share to cap this off, is that there's things you're doing that are making a difference for eternity. And when you see this, this is a song many of you have heard before, I'm sure, called Thank You, but there's some video behind it. And it's a little more tuned toward missions giving, but the principle is still good for, principle still works for, any kind of activity you do for Jesus, that when you do this, it's going to make a difference. And I want you to be encouraged to see someday, this is really the reward that I'm going to get. And this surpasses anything you're going to find on this planet. I want you to be encouraged, because I know all of you are involved in things that are making a difference for the kingdom of God. Do we have anything? Sign in.
Yeah, sign in to Microsoft. We know where our sign in is.
All right. Yes, why don't you do that? Oh, that wasn't for you. Does anybody want to give us a testimony while we see if we can work something out here? Maybe about last night that God did anything. Anybody want to share anything? Uh-oh. I'm going to go look.
Most recently, I was at work, and I have a friend that, I don't know if I've mentioned her before, for the first 3 or 4 years we worked together, I'd say good morning, and she'd go, you know. She wasn't very friendly, and so my goal with my annual review was to make friends with her and get her to like me, and it started slowly, but she's come to me and talked about going to church, and we've talked about God, and et cetera. The other day, I was looking at my finances, and I'm like, it's not looking very good. And I was telling her about it, and I was instant messaging her. She sits right next to me, but we instant message everything. And we become friends. She said that at one point that I was one of her best friends. Now it's been 6 years, so I praise God for that, because one day I was like, I'm going to go pray over her chair after she leaves, and I did. And the next day, she was really friendly and a lot more friendly. But I was messaging her, and I was like, oh, this is going on, and my finances aren't going so well. And I was like, oh, it's payday. So I went and looked at my check, and I forgot that my boss was giving us payout for our vacation. So my paycheck was like $500 extra. And I was like, so I could message her right back and say, hey, praise God, you know, this just happened. And she's like, wow, that's awesome. So I just wanted to share that, you know, God does a lot of that. How's it going, Pastor? Okay. I also, I got a whole routine. If you want, I can stand up here for now. I recently started driving Lyft, and I've had the opportunity to meet a lot of people, a lot of interesting people last night. And I was at a liquor store letting somebody run in last night. And on the sign it said, Natural Light, it was a beer. And said, every gnat is a story. And I thought, you know, every ride that I'm taking is a story. I usually have the radio on WBCL. And when they get in, I say, is the temperature okay? Or do you want me to change the radio? And everybody's like, oh, it's fine. Some people have asked me to turn it up. I think 2 people asked me to change it. But, you know, there's been a couple people that said, oh, I need to listen to some Christian music. And so I'm enjoying that as an opportunity to witness. Are you sure nobody else has anything? Nothing about last night. I'm looking at you, Stephanie. I did.
We're gonna give it a try here, and if this doesn't work, we'll just skip it. So I'm not gonna make you wait here all day while we try to do technical things. Go ahead, Mike, hit the button. Let's see if we got sound connected. Just click on the screen. The PowerPoint screen. Is that doing anything?
No.
All right. Now there's another lesson God wants to teach us here about preparation. There we go. Where's the video? We'll just listen.
That was changed. picture. These pictures made you cry. You didn't have much money, but you gave it anyway. Jesus took the gift you gave, and that's why I'm here today. Thank you for giving to the Lord. I am a life that was changed. One by one they came, far as the eye could see. Each life somehow touched by your generosity. Little things that you had done, sacrifices made, unnoticed on the earth, in heaven now proclaimed. I know up in heaven you're not supposed to cry, but I am almost sure there were tears in your eyes as Jesus took your hand and you stood before the Lord. He said, my child, look around you, for great is your reward. Thank you for giving to the Lord. I am a life that was changed. Thank you for giving to the Lord. I am so
Did you find that encouraging? Was that worth waiting on? All right. Actually, I kind of liked it better without the video now that I think about it. It was good to just hear that. Well, friends, I want you to be encouraged in your giving, in everything you're doing, that you do for Jesus. It's going to count someday. And you can't even imagine what happened in heaven. We're going to have emotions in heaven. More than we do now. And to be able to see that the things we've done have made a difference for eternity. That's a big deal. Father, I pray you bless your people today and let them be encouraged, Father. I thank you for the things that they're doing, Lord God, the way they reach out to others, the way they help each other, the sacrifices they make for their own families, for others, Lord God. And I pray they be encouraged with this word on giving. The giving in finances, Lord God, for the church and for missions, but the giving in time and the giving in heart. Let your people be blessed and encouraged as they continue to follow after you and help them to truly experience life in the kingdom. Thank you so very much, Lord God. Thank you. And before we go, let's just stay in an attitude of prayer. Let me just ask if anybody today, if you need to be saved, if you need to be born again, Heaven is promised to us, but not because we're good enough. We do these righteous things, but none of that counts at all toward our salvation. None of it counts at all toward our salvation. The only thing that counts is when we realize that our good works will never, ever get us into heaven. And the only thing that we can get in is when we surrender and say, I need a Savior. And that's what Jesus came to do, to take our sin away upon himself, as we saw in the blood and the cup and the wine, that is his blood dying in our place is the only ticket to heaven. Nobody gets in on their merit because we just don't merit enough. So I want to ask if you would like to say a prayer today for Jesus to come into your heart, to change your life, to take your sin away. Just raise your hand right now and I'll pray for you if there's anybody today anywhere. Just raise your hand. Give just a moment. All right, I see one hand up. And I want to ask if all of you could just say this prayer after me. Father in heaven, thank you for Jesus. Thank you that he took my sin upon his body and died on the cross for me. Forgive me of my sins. Make me whole. And I make you Lord and will follow you all the days of my life. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. All right. God is good. Amen. Well, I certainly had an awkward end to this, but I think we finished it well. But thank you for being here. God bless you. Don't be in a hurry to leave. Greet one another as you go today. Oh, is there anything I need to remember on the way out? Lisa has cards in the back. We still need sign-ups for the carnival. And remember to do likes and shares on Facebook on the ad, which should... Shares. The shares. Put shares, put it on your face, which helps us, but then other people see it too on your Facebook page, so that's good. That's a double whammy. All right, that'll be your righteous act for the week. God bless you.